I want to thank you for honoring me with the opportunity to speak today. I have to admit that it's a bit humbling, even a little bit intimidating to be here with in such a group of intellectuals. It was interesting, when they introduced you, they talked about your intellect. When they introduced me, they talked about my activity and my energy. It reminds me of L.A. Times editorial. It said, talked about two candidates that had been endorsed, and they said, well, one of them was a man of great intellect and big ideas. And they said, and then they described me, and they said, and Antonio Villaraigosa, well, he's smart enough. But he's got a reputation for bringing the best and the brightest around him, and I'm very proud of that. And so I'll try to glean some of that intellect from all of you and just say to you that I'm very thankful to be here with you. You've heard me say many times, I love this country. This is the greatest country anywhere in the world. This is the country that's given me so much, given my grandfather, who got here 100 years ago, more than he could have ever imagined. And this is a place where immigrants come from every corner of the earth. And where else could someone like me, the son and the grandson of immigrants, get a second chance in life and go on to become the chief executive of the second largest city of the greatest nation in the world? And what a city it is, a leading international metropolis that is positively alive with diversity and pulsating with the promise that diversity brings. It's here where we come with our hopes and dreams from every corner of the earth, and here where we come from every part of the United States to make our dreams come true. Here we are poised at the gateway of the Pacific Rim and Latin America and the great consumer markets of North America. In a city where 120 languages are spoken, where the changing demographic face of America is taking shape right before our eyes. Where we truly live in a microcosm of America's biggest challenges and greatest hopes. It's an obvious statement of fact that LA's future and California's future and America's future will be written in the story of how we deal with our immigrant and underserved minority populations. And we should have no illusions. These are complex challenges. Challenges that, in my view, are distorted in a simplistic public debate that is far too focused on a group of extremists calling themselves Minutemen, and whose adoption of that label is an affront to all immigrants and to all Americans. I think we should applaud President Bush for having the courage to speak out against the Minutemen, and I mean that. And while we're doing so, we should take a moment to remember who the real Minutemen were. We should remember that as many as half, I said half, of the men who fought the American Revolution were Scotch-Irish immigrants, people down on their luck, refugees in a 100-year migration, who first fled the poverty and the political violence of the Scottish lowlands, and then a century later set sail from Ireland to America to escape the religious intolerance and the punitive economic policies of the British Crown. We should remember the stories of the real Minutemen and tell the story of America, because they are the people that have made America great. A story that's been reaffirmed in every generation by immigrants, not just from Ireland, from Mexico, from China, from every corner of the earth. And it doesn't matter if that story began at a dockyard in Ulster or at the border crossing in San Isidro. It is the common thread that runs through the life and the lineage of every person in this room. You see, we all trace our roots to the same dream. We are all the offspring of men and women who traversed oceans and crossed deserts to get here, many of whom came with little more than the shirts on their backs, some of whom came here in chains. And they built our economy, and they worked nearly every day of their lives, and they suffered all the insults and humiliations that immigrants everywhere endure. Ladies and gentlemen, we should always remember that America was not built by people with trust funds. It was made in the toil and in the dreams of its immigrants. Now, I know that there are some who say this is nice, but a nostalgic view, that we live in a much different world today. that the old economic growth model of the 20th century, based on large numbers of manufacturing jobs providing opportunity for upward mobility, is no more. That the percentage of the population earning income in the manufacturing sector has dropped to just 11%. That a simple high school education isn't going to cut it in the economy of the 21st century. That despite this reality, minority and immigrant children are dropping out of school at alarming and unacceptable rates. And that the presence of a population without adequate education and skills places serious and unsustainable pressures on our systems of medical care and insurance. And you know what? People are correct to raise these questions. The challenges are real. We should talk about education policy consistent with our national interest. But while we're talking about costs, shouldn't we also be discussing the benefits immigrants bring to this great country? Ladies and gentlemen, I can't say it more clearly. America's future depends on its immigrants, and we will not succeed unless our immigrant and minority communities succeed. Consider the greatest dilemma of our lifetime, how to pay for the retirements and the medical needs of the baby boom generation. Who's going to do it? The greatest unspoken truth is that we cannot face this challenge, as David Bautista has said so many times, without depending heavily on the contributions of immigrants and without fully integrating our immigrant and underserved minority populations into the economy. And I'm talking about the new economy. We can't honor our commitments to the elderly and maintain our standard of living as a nation without relying on the contributions of newcomers and without bringing these people along into the mainstream of American life. You've heard me say many times that this city is the city of America's hope and its promise. It's the city where some 30 different nationalities have their largest population here outside of their country of origin. This is the city where the world meets. This is the city with the third largest port and the fifth busiest airport, with a portal to the east where the growing economies are, a portal to the south where the growing markets are. Our destiny is to be the Venice of the 21st century. The question is, will we take our rightful place and take that destiny to where we can take it? And the answer is, it's up to us. It's up to us to understand that what this report shows is that Latino and Hispanic incomes are rising and will continue to rise at a rate faster than the population at large. It's up to us to do something to promote public policy that encourages that, that sustains it, that gives it the vibrancy that it could be if they were invested in. This very important report predicts that as Latinos earn more, that they will spend more on health care and insurance and home ownership. That's a great thing. That's great for our economy. It's great for all of those who believe that our housing market is going in another direction soon. It advises corporate America that the companies capturing the growing Latino market will enjoy a distinct competitive advantage. Chancellor Carnicell had a moment, a few moments more, to talk about how I addressed the issue of outreach when I was a regent here at the UC system. What I said to them was simple. Don't be for this because you want to be for human rights and civil rights and because you want to do the right thing. Be for this because this is where America and California are going. Be for this because this is a smart investment in the future. Be for this because our ability to educate all of the people in our great state, in a state that is changing dramatically before our eyes, is the key to sustaining that future and taking it beyond where it will go if we don't do it. And it underscores the central challenges that we face. How do we improve the education we provide to immigrants and minorities? How do we foster the growth of business in immigrant and underserved communities? And how to seize the opportunities presented by our diversity? Here we are. Think about it. This diversity that we talk about, and Latinos are such a big part of, this diversity that we talk about and get excited about is not just great, as I said, for human rights and civil rights. It's the key to our destiny as a region. Because with those 30 different nationalities, not just the Latinos, but the 30 different nationalities that have their largest population here, with the third largest port and the fifth busiest airport, our ability to connect these people to their countries of origin is going to go a long way to making us a very rich and prosperous region, the mover of goods from the east, the sender of goods to the south, and our ability to have an educated workforce, our ability to give those people the housing that they need is going to be key. Our ability to give them the jobs is essential for them to live the American dream and for us to sustain our quality of life. We are committed to expanding opportunities for Latino and immigrant and minority kids to enter universities like UCLA and to succeed once they get here, to work in partnership with our leading colleges and universities to do something about turning the clock forward instead of back, to address the fact that great universities like this, despite all the outreach, still don't reflect the demographics of the state and the city. And our goal has to be to graduate a student body that looks like Los Angeles and California, because these are going to be the leaders that represent the many ethnic communities that make up this city. We need to make long-needed improvements to the LA Unified School District, and when you hear me almost ad nauseum talk about our schools, I do that not because I'm an educator, but because someone gave me a second chance. And I know how critical a good education is, the ability to communicate, the ability to read and write in a language, the ability to be able to think critically, to be able to take on those tough jobs. This is our challenge, to prepare all of these people for the new economy and for the future in the city, to promote the growth of LA businesses that will provide real job opportunities. And the forecast today gave us, you know, some insightful information about where those sectors are that we can support and grow and nourish so that LA is growing and prospering together and not leaving so many people behind. And to foster the idea that LA's population is our major asset that can be tapped to boost our city's role in international trade, especially with countries to the east and the south. We need to help build the infrastructure and the relationships to facilitate natural trade relationships between Mexican Americans and Mexico, between Salvadorian Americans and El Salvador, between all of the Latin Americans that live here in Latin America. And the same is true for the Asians, because that is, and the Europeans, because that is going to be LA's destiny. And so I thank all of you who are here today, the UCLA Business School, the Forecast Group, Goldman Sachs, all of you who are here, because today was a very important day. This wasn't just the Chicano Studies Department, who might have put out and have been putting out some of this information for a long time. David Hayes Bautista, who's been saying this for, you know, more than a decade with very few people listening. Now it's clear. This isn't just a group of ethnics saying this is what's good for Latinos in Los Angeles is good for Los Angeles. What we're saying is what I've been saying, a number of us have been saying for a long time. The Latino agenda is the American agenda. We've got to invest in housing and economic development. We've got to educate our people, because our ability to do those things will impact all of us. All of us will be lifted with our ability to lift up and invest in this very, very important community. And so I thank you for inviting me. Remember, as we travel around the city, though, and I really want you to think about this, remember all those folks bussing the tables and cleaning the homes, those folks who, you know, are your gardeners, those folks that work in restaurants all across the city that are starting small businesses in places like South Los Angeles. They're the real Minutemen. They're what made America great. Just like the Scotch-Irish, the Italians, the Jews, all of the great communities that have come to make America great. This new wave of people are not people that we should be threatened of. These new wave of people are people that we should embrace and invest in, and all of us will be the better for it. Thank you so much.